Well, good morning, and welcome once again to the Grace Community Church virtual service. It's our strong desire that you could be with us in person this morning, but things being what they are, you're going to have to enjoy us through the wonders of modern technology. So please sit back, worship with us, and thank you for being with us this morning.
Heavenly Father, we want the words that we speak to you, the words that we speak to one another, the words that we say within ourselves to be sincere and genuine. We pray, Father, that we wouldn't get caught up in life and the things that want to just carry us along and make us just complacent. We want to have a deeper walk with you, whatever that means. So, Father, be with us this morning as we pray, as we worship, and as we listen to the word. And thank you for your everlasting love. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Is too little. They let him go. They had no sudden healing. To think that providence would take a child from his mother while she prays is appalling. Who told us we'd be rescued What has changed and why should we be saved from nightmares? We're asking why this happens to us who have died to live. It's unfair. This is what it means to be held, how it feels when the sacred is torn from life and you survive. This is what it is to be loved and to know that the promise was when everything fell, we'd be held. This hand is bitterness. We want to taste it. Let the hatred numb our sorrow. Hand open slowly to lilies of the valley, and tomorrow this is what it means to be held, what it feels when the sacred is torn from your life and you survive. This is what it is to be loved and to know that the promise was when everything fell, we'd be held. If hope is born of suffering, if this is only the beginning, can we not wait for 1 hour watching for
All right, let's open with a word of prayer, and then we'll go to our message for today. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you bring us together today, that we have the freedom to meet, and once again, remember all of the events that have to do with your son, Jesus Christ's final week of life and ministry before his crucifixion and death. And we thank you, Lord, that we can look at those events today and see the incredible importance that Palm Sunday holds in your word and even in the general scheme of things as we consider the history of the world and everything else. So we thank you for this time. We pray you'll help us and your Holy Spirit would teach us as we look at your word and as we consider all the different passages that we'll see today. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, well, good morning, everybody. And today, as you see on the screen there, we're going to discuss the incredible importance of Palm Sunday because it is very incredibly important. And I know that many times when we get to these type of passages or these type of messages, like around the time of Easter and Christmas, people say, well, I've heard this so many times, and we saw it in the little clip right before the message with Jesus coming into Jerusalem, that famous movie, Jesus of Nazareth, with Robert Powell from back in the 1970s, and all the people shouting Hosanna and everything. And so we think, oh yeah, okay, it's the story of Jesus on the donkey and the people shouting, yeah, yeah. And we kind of click out. And I really don't think we should do that because really there's such an incredible importance about Palm Sunday that we're going to see in today's message. We're going to have our main passage is going to be in one of the Gospels, in the Gospel of Mark, but it's actually going to kind of summarize what's in all four Gospels, and we're going to see many other passages. Today we might even see close to 20 different Bible passages as we look at different prophetic scriptures in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and it's important to us because many of us are going through adverse circumstances. As we go through our lives and even just the situation in the world, the war in the Ukraine with Russia attacking unprovoked an innocent country, women and children being, civilians being killed, innocent people being slaughtered, and all of that taking place. And yet, if I were to tell you about another place in the world where innocent civilians are being killed indiscriminately and women and children, women are being raped, children are being maimed, you might think that I'm talking about Ukraine, but I'm not. I'm talking about the war in the Tigray region of Ethiopia that's been going on for over a year, year and a half. And then there's wars going on in Chad and in Nigeria, in Central African Republic, in Myanmar. There's places all around the world. There's like, I think, 20 armed conflicts or close to 20 going on right now around the world. And so adverse circumstances happen. And even in our own lives, some of us, like we just heard about the man whose father passed away this last week and how difficult it is when we lose a loved one, how maybe we get the bad news that the medical results, it's going to be cancer, or we have, like I shared in my message on Psalm 121 a few weeks ago, about all the things that we fear, you know, a car breakdown, losing your job, a terrorist attack, on and on and on. And one of the reasons why it's so important to come back to these set times that God has given us in Scripture, to remember the coming of Christ the first time, to remember the events surrounding his death and crucifixion. And all of those things are important because it's the Word of God in the Bible that when we consider these again and we see the importance of them, it gives us that renewed hope that we have that God has revealed certain things and he's also revealed his Son and he's done certain things in his Son. And all of that should give us renewed hope. And so that's the thing that we want to consider today as we go through that. And we look at the incredible importance of Palm Sunday and see about Jesus as the Messiah and also Jesus and how we should respond to him. So let's look at the scripture passage. This is our theme verse for this message, Mark chapter 11, verse 7 through 10. I'm reading from the New American Standard, and it says, "And they brought the colt to Jesus and put their garments on it, and he sat upon it. And many spread their garments in the road, and others spread leafy branches which they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed after were crying out, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.'" So this is the key passage. And as I said before, this also is related in Matthew, in Luke, and in John. And that's another thing that's very important about this. As we look at all these different events that have to do with Easter or the time around Christ's death, crucifixion and death, it's in all four of the Gospels. Not even his birth is in all four. We just saw a few months back that Christ's birth is talked about in Matthew and in Luke, but it's not in Mark and John. And yet here we have all the events of Christ's final week are in all four Gospels. And that gives it an incredible importance, because if you study all four Gospels and you see the percentage of material that they give on an average, some give a little bit more, some a little less, but on average about 60% of all four Gospels deals with Christ's 3.5 years of ministry, and of course Matthew and Luke, his birth and some of his early years. But basically 60% of the Gospels deals with Christ's 3.5 year ministry, and then 40% deals just with the last eight or nine days from the time he got to Lazarus's house and resurrected Lazarus in John chapter 11. And then John chapter 12 is this passage of the triumphal entry. So as we look at the different four Gospels, we see that so much of the material, 40%, is dedicated just to these last 8 or 9 days. So that makes it very, very significant and very important. And so the first thing, we're going to look at this and we're going to see two things in today's passage. We're going to see, first we're going to see the prophetic importance of the triumphal entry. So the first thing to write in on your bulletin insert there is that word that's underlined in the presentation, the prophetic importance of the triumphal entry. And we're going to see several different prophecies that help us to understand that when Christ entered Jerusalem on that first Sunday, it wasn't just that he picked that day because it was close or he was there or because he knew there were going to be a lot of people. It's actually, he's fulfilling many different prophecies, and that's what we want to see as we look at this first area of the prophetic importance of the triumphal entry. So, first of all, it fulfilled the prophecy of Messiah's entry into Jerusalem, and in the way, that's the next thing for you to fill in on the blank there, in the way specified. So we're going to see here, look at Zechariah verse 9:9. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem." Both those are synonymous for the city of Jerusalem. "Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, humble and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So Jesus is coming the way this prophecy was set up in Zechariah. Now let's look and see what Matthew says. He says, "Now this took place," Matthew 21, 4 and 5. "Now this took place," Jesus coming into the city on a donkey, "that what was spoken through the prophet," Zechariah, we just read it, "might be fulfilled, saying," and now Matthew quotes the same passage, Zechariah 9, verses 9 and 8, he says, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, gentle and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." And then in John chapter 12, when John's talking about this, it says, "And Jesus, finding a young donkey, sat on it as it is written." See, and he quotes from this prophecy in Zechariah, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming seated on a donkey." So what we're seeing is Jesus didn't enter Jerusalem riding a mule, like some of the kings in the Old Testament did. He didn't enter Jerusalem riding a, you know, white stallion with his sword upraised as a, you know, conquering Roman would have done. He came in riding a donkey. He didn't come in walking. He didn't come having them carry him on a litter that, you know, like he was some kind of a pharaoh or some important king. He came on a donkey. Why did he do that? Matthew says, because he's fulfilling the prophecy that was written about the Messiah entering Jerusalem on a donkey. And so it's very important. Look at this quote from Warren Wiersbe. This is what he says. "This was the only time in his ministry that Jesus actually planned and promoted a public demonstration. Up to this time, he had cautioned people not to tell who he was. Why did Jesus plan this demonstration? For one thing," now look what Warren Wiersbe says, "he was obeying the word and fulfilling the prophecy recorded in Zechariah 9:9. This prophecy could apply only to Jesus Christ, for he is the only one with credentials that prove he is Israel's king." And we saw that back at Christmas in the genealogies in Matthew and Luke, as Jimmy and I preached through those four messages in our Christmas series. So we know Jesus is Israel's king because his genealogy shows that, and he's coming in the way that it was prescribed for the Messiah to enter. So that's the first important prophetic point that we want to look at. Now let's look at the second one. It fulfilled the prophecy of one coming in the name of the Lord. He wasn't coming in the name of Caesar. He wasn't coming in the name of the high priest of that year. He wasn't coming in the name of whoever. He was coming in the name of the Lord. And the people were shouting that out. And they were quoting one of the Psalms of Ascents that the pilgrims would sing on their way up to Jerusalem during these times of the Jewish feasts. And so he's coming also into Jerusalem. Now, that's another thing. He didn't go to Bethlehem where he was born. He didn't enter the city of Capernaum where they oftentimes had rejected him and say, hey, here I am. And look, I'm going to put it in your face that you guys rejected me, but I'm the Messiah. He entered Jerusalem. And we're going to see why it had to be that way from, again, several prophetic passages that he had to come in the name of the Lord, name of Yahweh, that's the tetragrammaton there in the Old Testament, in the name of Jehovah God, Yahweh, the four special letters for God's name, and he came in the name of God. He was coming in the name of God as the Messiah and coming into Jerusalem, not any other city, not Caesarea where the Herodian kings had their palace, not coming into Bethlehem where he was born. He's coming into Jerusalem. Look what it says in Psalm 118, because the people were quoting this as he was coming. They were shouting this out. Oh, Lord, do save. That's Hosanna. We beseech thee. Oh, Lord, we beseech thee. Do send prosperity. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. So the people are shouting this out when Jesus is riding into Jerusalem on the donkey. And then in Isaiah 62:11, it says, behold, the Lord has proclaimed to the end of the earth, say to the daughter of Zion. Again, that's a figure of speech for the city of Jerusalem. Lo, your salvation comes. Behold, his reward is with him, his recompense before him. So the people are saying all this. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Blessed is the salvation that's arriving. And they're saying all these different phrases that are coming from these prophetic passages. And that's very important. Look what Dr. Merrill Tenney wrote many years ago. He said, they applied, these are the people in the crowd, the multitude, they applied to him the words of Psalm 118, 25 and 26, one of the songs of degrees or ascents as the people went up to Jerusalem, customarily sung by Passover pilgrims on their way to Jerusalem. Look what he said, Dr. Tenney. These words ascribed to him, Jesus, a messianic title as the agent of the Lord God, the Lord of Israel, the coming King of Israel. So Dr. Tenney is saying that the people are recognizing and ascribing to Jesus that he's the coming messianic king, coming in the name of the Lord, coming into Jerusalem. So that's another second point that shows the prophetic importance of the triumphal entry. Now look at the third point, and this is where you can fill in that third blank. Fulfilled the prophecy of the time for Messiah to arrive. Now this is very important, and we're going to spend a little more time on this point because it's so important. That was no pun intended about the time, but we're going to spend some time here. Daniel chapter 9, verse 24 through 26 is in the middle of this prophecy that the angel Gabriel gave to Daniel when he had been reading the book of Jeremiah. He had been captive in Babylon almost 70 years. He was taken as a young teenage boy, 15, 16, maybe 17 years old. And now he was in his mid-80s, and he's calculating, and he's saying, you know, I've been here almost 7 years. He was reading the prophecy in Jeremiah where God told, through Jeremiah, told the people of Israel, you're going to be taken captive, and you're going to be in Babylon for 70 years, and then you're going to come back. And so Daniel's thinking in his mind, well, I was taken such and then, I've been here so many. And he says, he started praying in Daniel chapter 9. He prayed for 3 weeks, and then the angel Gabriel came and gave him a prophecy that's known as the 70 weeks prophecy. It's not weeks, but it's really 77s that he said are decreed for your people. Now, who are Daniel's people? The Jewish nation. And he says, and your holy city. What is Daniel's holy city? The city of Jerusalem. So this whole prophecy, the whole 77s, has to do with the Jewish nation and with the city of Jerusalem. And look what he says. So you are to know and discern that from, now he's going to give some time periods here, from the issuing of a decree to rebuild Jerusalem until the Messiah, the prince, there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Add that up. That's 69, all right? All right, and then the second half of that, after the 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off and have nothing. So he's setting up some periods of time here. He's saying there's going to be a period of 69 sevens, which we know from history are sevens of years, 7 year periods. All right. So 69 periods of 7 years, which is 483 years from the decree that Nehemiah received in 444 BC until Jesus rode into Jerusalem around 30 AD. Okay. And so he's coming into the city of Jerusalem after, from until he's coming. And then after he came into Jerusalem, not during the 69th seven, But after that, it says the Messiah will be cut off. And if we will read the rest of the passage, it says, and the city and the sanctuary or the temple will be destroyed by the people of a prince who is yet to come. And those were the Romans in 70 AD. So we see this time that we can trace it back in history and see that literally from the decree that Artaxerxes gave to Nehemiah until Christ coming into Jerusalem, the 69 weeks of things came to pass. And then after that period, the Messiah was cut off and he was crucified and died. And then the city and the sanctuary were destroyed. I should have put that last phrase in there in the rest of verse 26a, but I just wanted us to get this. Now look what Luke says. When he approached, this is again, Jesus during the triumphal entry, when he approached, he saw the city and wept over it. Now look what Jesus is going to say. If you had known even you in this, your, what does it say? Your day, the things which make for peace. See, he's talking about a period of time, but now they are hidden from you because you did not know the time of your visitation. So Jesus is telling them, look, from the decree that Nehemiah got until this day, you guys should be aware that the prophecy that Daniel received from the angel Gabriel is being fulfilled, and you should be rejoicing. And instead, the leaders are going to reject him. And then in John chapter 12, Jesus answered them. And this is when some Greeks come seeking Jesus, and they tell the disciples, we want to see Jesus. And so they go and tell Jesus. And all through the Gospel of John, like three times prior to chapter 12, when the people wanted to try and forcibly make Jesus become the Messiah at a certain time, Jesus always eluded them because it was not his time. And he always said, or John said as the narrator, his hour had not yet come. And yet, look what Jesus says here. When these Greeks come seeking him, he answers, the disciples said, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. The specific time had arrived for this to be fulfilled. Now, look what Dr. Barbieri wrote on this when he's talking about Jesus entering Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. Jesus may have well have had in mind the significant prophecy of Daniel concerning the time of Messiah's coming, and that he had arrived in Jerusalem at the very time predicted by Daniel, actually by Gabriel, but written by Daniel, over 500 years previously. This event marked the official presentation of Jesus Christ to the nation of Israel as the rightful son of David, as the Messiah, the one who was to come. So it's very important that we see that Jesus fulfilled the prophecy of the exact time for the Messiah to arrive. Now, the final prophetic importance that we're going to see, or the important prophetic thing, is that it fulfilled the exact day that the sacrificial lambs had to be taken into the home. In Exodus chapter 12, when Moses is still leading Israel during the time of the plagues, they're going to be coming out of Egypt soon. On the night when the angel of death came across the firstborn and took the firstborn of everybody, God established the Passover. And he's telling Moses here, he's saying, on the 10th of this month, they are each one to take a lamb for themselves. Each Jewish family take a lamb into their father's, according to their father's household, take a lamb for each household, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. So on the 10th of the month of the first month of the Jewish calendar, the month of Nisan, the 10th of Nisan, they had to bring a lamb into the family and wait until Passover day to sacrifice it. So Jesus comes into Jerusalem on the 10th of Nisan. We're going to see that in a second. Look at John 1, 29 and 35 and 36. The next day, John the Baptist, saw Jesus coming and said, here he gives the title, who's Jesus? Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And again, the next day, John stood with two of his disciples and looking at Jesus as he walked, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. So Jesus is the Lamb of God. Let's see another couple passages. Isaiah 53, the servant song, where it talks about the servant of Jehovah, the servant of Yahweh being sacrificed. It says, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet did not open his mouth like a lamb that is led to slaughter, like a sheep that's silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. And then in Revelation, the last book of the Bible, we see John in the vision he's having up in heaven. I saw between the throne with the four living creatures and the elders, a lamb standing as if slain. And when he had taken the book, the four living creatures, that's the book with the seven seals that starts off all the judgments in the book of Revelation. And when he had taken the book, the four living creatures, the 24 elders fell down before the lamb and they sang a new song saying, worthy are you. And I heard this voice of many angels saying with a loud voice, worthy is the lamb that was slain. So Jesus is that lamb. Look what Matthew Henry commented. And this was, again, I love Matthew Henry because he's so back in the early 18th century that you can't accuse him of getting involved in all of the political and theological debates that have been going on the last couple hundred years. But Matthew Henry said, all the four evangelists take notice of this passage of Christ's riding in triumph into Jerusalem. We said that's important. 5 days before his death. Now look what he says. The Passover was on the 14th day of the month of Nisan. Passover on the 14th day. And this was the 10th of Nisan, on which day the law appointed that the Paschal lamb should be taken up and set apart for that service. And on that day, therefore, Christ, our Passover, like Paul calls him in his letter to the Corinthians, who was to be sacrificed for us, was publicly showed. So do you see the significance of this? Jesus didn't come in to the triumphal entry on Saturday, which would have been illegal because it was the Sabbath, but he didn't wait until Monday. He didn't do it the day before Passover. He didn't do it on the day of Passover. He's coming in on the day when the law of Moses said that the families had to bring the lamb into the home. And Jesus, as the Lamb of God, comes into the home of God, quote unquote, the city of Jerusalem, which is God's chosen city, God's home. He's bringing the lamb into the family home on the exact day that the law required. And that's very important to note prophetically. So we've seen these 4 points. Jesus fulfilled the prophecy of Messiah entering into Jerusalem, the way specified, coming in the name of the Lord and into the city specified, at the time specified, and on the day that the lambs, sacrificial lambs, had to be taken into the home. So look at this. Only Jesus Christ has fulfilled the messianic prophecies, entering Jerusalem in the way, in the place, and at the time prophesied. No one else ever has, and no one else ever can now, because the time has passed for his first coming and his death and resurrection. And then we know that because there's a rule in hermeneutics that if a prophecy, like the one in Daniel's 70 weeks, if 69 weeks of that prophecy were fulfilled literally, and then until the coming of Messiah was fulfilled literally, and then after the coming of the Messiah, he was cut off, but not of his own. And then the city and the temple were destroyed. That happened literally also in history. And that was a like we could call it a gap or a parenthesis after the 69 weeks. And then for 1 week, it says in the prophecy, so many other things are going to happen. But that 1 week, which is the 70th block of 7 years, the 70th has never happened in history. So we know it's still going to happen literally at some point, because the rules of hermeneutics say if the prophecy has been literal from the beginning all the way up to that point, The rule of sequence says you can't have 99% of the sequence literal and only 1% be figurative or symbolic. So we know it's going to happen literally. But because that time has ended, the time ended in the first century, nobody since that time can come and now and claim to be the Messiah and fulfill it, because the time has passed way, way past the 69 sevens. And what happened after happened literally. So we know that's been fulfilled. The only thing that hasn't been fulfilled is the 70th block of 7 years, which is the tribulation period that will come, and that's described in the book of Revelation. All right, the second thing we're going to see is the proper response. Not only does Palm Sunday have an incredible importance because it has the prophetic importance that was fulfilled, but also there's a proper response that we should have to the triumphal entry. So let's go look at this. And what we're going to see is that the response is that everybody blew it. Everybody didn't get it. First of all, the disciples failed to get it. Okay, they just didn't get it. Remember how often during his ministry he would say, don't you guys understand this yet? Are you so hard-hearted that you're not getting this? And over he would have to kind of chide them or rebuke them because they weren't getting it. Look what it says here in John 12. These things, this is talking about the day of the triumphal entry, John chapter 12, and the Greeks coming to look for him and all the stuff going on. Says these things his disciples did not understand at the first. Now, this is John writing, you know, years later, maybe 60 years later. He's an elderly man around 90 AD, and he's writing this, remembering as the Holy Spirit brings to memory the things that happened. He says, these things his disciples did not understand at the first. But when Jesus was glorified, they remembered that these things were written of him and that they had done these things to him. Look what Dr. Bloom says in his commentary on John. The disciples, though close to Jesus and participants in these events, did not understand them. They lacked the perspective of the cross and the resurrection. They were unaware that Zechariah's prophecy had been written about him, Jesus. So the disciples are seeing all this stuff going on, the people shouting, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They're seeing all these prophetic things being fulfilled. And they know Jesus is the Lamb of God because for 3 years earlier, John the Baptist said so. And they're seeing all this happen, and they're just not getting it. They're failing to get it. But later, after he was resurrected, and then he taught them for 40 days before the ascension, later they did get it, and John recognizes that. He says, we didn't get it at first, but when Jesus was glorified, when he was resurrected, then we remembered these things and that we had done these things to him. So that's an important thing. Jesus or the disciples failed to get it right. And then the second group we see that failed to get it right are the people. The people failed to get it right. We saw in that little video clip when some of the leaders asked common people, who is this? Oh, it's Jesus of Nazareth. And then they turned to someone and say, who is that? Who's Jesus of Nazareth? Well, he's a prophet. Okay, look what it says here in Matthew 21. And the multitudes going before him and those who followed after were crying out saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred saying, who is this? And the multitudes were saying, now they just said, he's the Son of David. He's the Messiah. He's the blessed coming in the name of the Lord. Now look what they say. This is the prophet, Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth. So they've already blown it. They're just not getting it. They think something's going to happen, but they're not seeing the full picture. So the people failed to get it right. And then the third group that failed to get it right were the religious leaders and the nation of Israel as a whole. All right. Look what it says in Luke 19. We saw this part of this passage just a little bit ago. And some of the Pharisees in the multitude said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples, okay? Because he's letting all these people acclaim him as the Messiah. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Blessed are you, and all, on and on. And so the Pharisees are upset. They said, this is almost blasphemous. Teacher, rebuke them. And he answered and said, I tell you, if these become silent, the stones will cry out. And when he approached, he saw the city and wept over, saying, if you had known in this day, because you did not recognize. See, they're not getting it. They didn't know and they didn't recognize. They didn't understand the time of your visitation. Okay, so we saw part of that in the previous thing talking about the time. But now we're talking about how they just didn't get it. The religious leaders and the nation failed to get it. Look a couple more verses here in Luke. And when he was teaching daily in the temple, but the chief priests, that would be the Sadducees, and the scribes, so they would be from the Pharisees, and the leading men among the people were trying to destroy him. So see, the religious leaders don't want it. John 12, the Pharisees therefore said to one another, after they saw the Greeks coming and Jesus is not stopping it, they said, you see, look, you're not doing any good. Look, the whole world has gone after him. So the Pharisees, the priests, the scribes, the leading people, all these are people who are part of the nation. They're failing to get it right. They just aren't getting it right. And then look what Warren Wiersbe says in this quote. This is great. But the Jews still did not recognize Jesus as their king. What caused Israel's spiritual blindness? For one thing, their religious leaders, see, there we're talking, that's the group we're talking about. Their religious leaders had robbed them of the truth of their own word and had substituted man-made traditions. Luke 11, 52, that's the same passage where Jesus in I think it's Matthew 15 and in Mark chapter 7, he has this big argument with the Pharisees saying, you guys with your traditions have nullified the word of God, because the word of God says a person should take care of their parents when they're elderly. And you say, no. But if he says, oh, but all I have to help my parents, I've dedicated it to the Lord as an offering and I can't use it. You let him get out of his responsibility to his parents. And he says, and you do many such things as this. So they had substituted tradition for the word of God. And so the leaders they didn't care about the word of God. They cared about their tradition, their status, and their place. And so look what Wiersbe finishes this. He says, the leaders were not interested in truth. They were concerned only with protecting their own interests. And that's why they didn't get it, okay? So the application we can get from this, as we draw close to the conclusion here, is that now we have the opportunity to get it right and to understand who Jesus is, what he did, and why it's so important, why Palm Sunday comes every year and God gives us another opportunity to hear it again and get it right. And I hope and I really trust that everybody here today has gotten it right at some point. But you never know, with a few visitors and others, that somebody might be out there who hasn't gotten it right. You might be like the disciples. You've heard it for a long time. Now, we had a lady in our church in Puebla for many, many years. We helped her. Her two sons were on drugs. And when we started the church, about a year after the church started, we helped get her two sons off to rehab centers where they got off of drugs. And out of gratitude, this lady came to our church for 10 years, never made a profession of faith in Christ. For 10 years. loving all of our company and the praise time and everything, and feeling like we really cared about her, but she never made a profession of faith in Christ. She never outwardly said, I believe in Jesus. And for 10 years, she didn't get it. And then 4 months before she passed away, because she had a brain aneurysm, a stroke, and it killed her almost instantly. But 4 months before that, a lady from our church, one of our coworkers, went to visit her for the umpteenth time at her home to share the gospel with her, and she finally got it, and she finally understood and accepted Christ as her Savior. And I wish that you could have seen, Antonia was her name, Antonia's face those last 4 months when she came to church. It had a different, her semblance was totally different. It was like she had a joy, a radiance that was just coming from her, because now she had gotten it. She knew who Jesus was. He was her Savior, and she understood who Jesus was. And so today we have the chance to get it. But the first step, you have to understand the gospel about Jesus. You have to understand what we've been sharing about the prophetic importance to have the proper response. And you have to understand it and get it, that Jesus is the one true promised Messiah. We saw that at Christmas. Now we're seeing it again. But you have to understand the gospel. And then the second thing, you have to truly believe or trust in Him as your Savior. If you don't take that second step, it doesn't matter if you understand the first one. You can understand it all you want, but if you leave this life without trusting in Christ, your eternity is going to be separated from God for all eternity. And so you need to have the second step of truly believing in Christ as your Savior. And then the third one that's not on the slide, but it's in the bulletin, says you have to follow Him with all your life. And we saw that in the message last week in Philippians chapter 3. We have to do just one thing. And all of us can do one thing, and that's to keep our focus on Christ and follow Christ. We're going to see a quote now by Alfred Edersheim. This is a very interesting and important person in the history of modern Christianity. Edersheim was a Jew, and he converted to Christianity. He was from, I believe it was from Vienna, Austria. And when he was 18 or 19, he was reached by some mission that worked to reach the Jewish people. And he converted to Christ. And then he went to study in England at Oxford or Cambridge, one of those big universities. And when he was in his like 40s or 50s, he was one of the experts on Christianity in relation to its Jewish origins. And he wrote this book. It's still a classic. And anyone who studies the life of Christ needs to consult Edersheim's book. It's called The Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah. And we're going to get this quote right out of there toward the end of his book. I mean, it's a huge book. It's like, you know, 1,000 or 1,200 pages. It's got huge footnotes in it. Great footnotes, because he quotes from the Mishnah and the Talmud and the Targums and all these Jewish sources that he knew how to read, because he spoke obviously Hebrew and he knew all this stuff. And it's just a goldmine of information about the life of Christ and all the relationship it has to the Jewish nation and the promises and the prophecies and everything. Look what he says. We turn once more to the scene just described. This is after he's all explained everything about the triumphal entry on Palm Sunday. He says, we turn once more to the scene just described, for it was no common pageantry. And now this is in, you know, English from 1880. I forgot to tell you, the book was written in 1880. So this is, you know, Oxford style English from, you know, the Victorian era. So it says, it was no common pageantry, and Christ's public entry into Jerusalem seems so altogether different from, we had almost said inconsistent with, his previous mode of appearance. Evidently, the time for the silence so long enjoined had passed, and that for public declaration had come, and such indeed this entry was. From the moment of his sending forth the two disciples to his acceptance of the homage of the multitude, crying out, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, all that, and his rebuke of the Pharisees attempting to arrest or stop that praise, all must be regarded as designed or approved by him. Now look what Edersheim says, not only a public assertion of his messiahship, but a claim to its national acknowledgement. Jesus was saying, the nation should recognize and accept me. And yet even so, says Edersheim, concluding, it was not to be the Messiah of Israel's conception, but he of prophetic picture, just and having salvation. Just means righteous, just, humble, and having salvation. So you see how Edersheim is bringing forth everything about this incredible importance of Palm Sunday. And just to conclude here, Palm Sunday is the incredibly important reminder that Jesus is the one true Messiah prophesied by the Bible, that he came at the appointed time as the Lamb of God and the servant of God who takes away, the servant of the Lord, who takes away the sin of our world, our sin, okay? And that's what we need to remember and hang on to that every year as we go to Palm Sunday and have that as something that would re-inspire the hope in us that God has revealed that he exists. He has revealed that he cares about us. He's revealed that his son was sent at exactly the time he was supposed to. And he's revealed that his salvation is available to anyone who would believe in Jesus and his work on the cross. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what we've seen about the incredible importance of Palm Sunday in your word today. Many different passages. I know, Lord, it's probably hard for some people to keep up as we looked at all these Old Testament passages and New Testament passages and quotes from different scholars trying to just drive home the fact that Palm Sunday has an incredible importance because it fulfilled so many prophecies, Lord, and it fulfilled so many other aspects of your word about the life and ministry of Messiah. And we thank you for that. Thank you what's registered in the four Gospels. We thank you for what we've seen today. And Lord, if anyone hasn't made that decision to really understand the gospel and put their faith in Christ, I pray that you would help them to do that today. And I thank you for it. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Once again, we thank you for being with us today. We love putting these videos on for you, and it's very joyous for us, and we love to worship with you, even though we can't be together. And if you like what you're hearing, please hit the like button on Facebook and YouTube. That way, anytime we have a new video coming out, you'll be the first to know. Thank you so much, and God bless, and we'll see you next week.